Good morning. Welcome to St. Petri Lutheran Church. This is the second Sunday after Epiphany. I'm Pastor Tim Malik. I'm glad you all are here, those of you in person, as well as those of you joining us online. Appreciate it very much. Just a note, we'll have announcements at the end of the service, but today is also our annual meeting, and there's a potluck with that. So I'm hoping that you're planning on staying after this service for that important meeting. Let's stand now as we begin worship with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us, that we may be reconciled to one another for the glory of your holy name. Amen. Thus says our God, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. We sing Rise, Shine, You People, hymn number 665. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also
with you. We're waiting for our keyboardist to change instruments, so no rush, please. There's. Thank you. be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, our strength and our Redeemer, by your Spirit hold us forever, that through your grace we may worship you and faithfully serve you, follow you, and joyfully find you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated for the readings.
The first reading comes from Isaiah. Listen to me, O coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, you are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified. But I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward with my God. And now the Lord says, who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him, for I am honored in the sight of the Lord. And my God has become my strength. He says, it is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and his Holy One, to one deeply despised, abhorred by the nations, the slave of rulers. Kings shall see and stand up, princes, and they shall prostrate themselves because of the Lord, who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. The word of the Lord. Join me in the psalm responsively. I waited patiently upon the Lord. He stooped to me and heard my cry. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many shall see and stand in awe and put their trust in the Lord. Great things are they that you have done, O Lord my God. How great your wonders and your plans for us. There is none who can be compared with you. In sacrifice and offering you take no pleasure. You have given me ears to hear you. In the roll of the book, it is written concerning me. I love to do your will. O my God, your law is deep in my heart. Your righteousness have I not hid in my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your deliverance. I have not concealed your love and faithfulness from the great congregation. A reading from 1 Corinthians. Paul called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Jesus Christ. For in every way you have been enriched in him in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in the spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite any kids forward for a children's message. Your name, I think I should know it, but is
Wesley.
It? Wesley. I wanted to say Willard, and that's not right. Wesley, yeah. Wesley, how are you doing today?
I'm not good.
Yeah? Okay.
Just fine.
Well, listen, you're going to help me help all these big kids here to think about names or titles that we use for Jesus. Because in the gospel passage, which we're going to read in a little bit, there's four different titles or names that are given to Jesus. So your name is Wesley. What are some other names that you might know? Do you just know like Mama and Dada?
Mama, Dada.
Do you have any pets Aiden at home?
Crash.
Yeah. Yeah, so what I want to do is, real quick, the titles that I want you to listen for when we read the passage are Lamb of God, Son of God, Rabbi, which means teacher, and I'm forgetting the fourth one, Messiah, anointed one. So those words are kind of big, so let's just look at some pictures around here in our church. We've got some symbols and stained glass windows, for example. Up here on the left, our left, the right of the congregation, you may not be able to read those words, but it says the Good Shepherd. And that's a picture of Jesus holding a little lamb, and there's a sheep by his feet. And so we sometimes refer to Jesus as the Good Shepherd. But in today's passage, Jesus is even referred to as a lamb. Yeah, a lamb that goes, baa. Can you say baa like a lamb?
Baa.
Baa. We have a song that we like to sing at camp called, I Just Want to Be a Sheep, baa, 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 baa. We'll teach that to you sometimes. It's got some funny words in it, too. Let's just walk down the aisle here a little bit. Now, that stained glass window just has the start of a hymn that Lutherans know, A Mighty Fortress. But that hymn talks about how God is our fortress. And I don't know if you can see that. It looks like an X and a P that's on the front of that. That's actually two Greek letters that are Chi, or it would be more properly pronounced, chi, and the letter rho. So that's actually like a CH sound and an R, which is the first letters in Christ. Yeah, so up there. So Christ the Lord. And we have pictures of Jesus on several of these. Probably a picture of the parable of the prodigal son. We have Jesus back here with the bread of Holy Communion and the words that we often hear around that. And then over here we have a picture of Jesus getting baptized. And our passage today is very similar, very close in the Bible to that story. But you can see the dove. Can you see a bird in that picture? Coming down, that represents the Holy Spirit. And so we know that Jesus is the chosen one. And that Jesus really is God. Now, one last thing. Come back up here with me. This symbol is a little harder to understand, maybe. But do you see that blue and white banner up there? It says, the way, the truth, and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Those symbols in the middle kind of represent something we call the Trinity. That's another way to talk about God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, or Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier. So the three sides of the triangle, three different parts, but still one. So God is one God, not three gods, but is three persons, not one person. And then kind of the three leaf, like on a clover, representing again God being three in one. Now, we've got some water in the font, and I always like to remind ourselves that with all those titles and names for God, they all have a lot of different meanings, but something that's similar is that God loves us, God claims us as one of God's children, and God is with us forever. So we can always remember our baptism as a way to remember that. So there's water in here. You want to get your finger in there? You can get it wet if you want to. You don't want to get wet? That's okay. So let me show you what I'm going to do. I'm going to get a little water. I'm going to take my glasses off so I don't get them wet. See my fingers wet? I'm going to make the sign of the cross on my forehead. And remember my baptism, and I'll say, I'm a child of God. Maybe grandma will... Do you want to do grandma? Do you want to get your finger wet and do grandma? No? Okay. Well, there was water in the font, and if you want to come later up and do this, it's fun. Sometimes it's fun to kind of play in the water a little bit. And when we do that, we remember that God loves us. So like in the morning when you wash your hands, you can put your water finger in water and make the sign of the cross and say, God loves me. Yeah, you want to do it? Okay. You want me to do it for you? God loves you. Okay. All right, you can go back to your seat. Thanks for coming up. Bye-bye, Wesley. Please stand for the gospel acclamation. The Holy Gospel according to John. John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. So if you were here the last week or so, I talked about the season of Epiphany. Just as a way of review, Epiphany again means to be made manifest, to be made known, to have something revealed to us. So this season of Epiphany, which is considered ordinary time, right? We're back to green pyramids, is a time when we learn more about who Jesus is and what's Jesus up to. So we had, you know, his baptism with the voice from heaven. "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." That's an epiphany. We learn a little bit more about who Jesus is. And today, the whole first part of John's gospel is full of things that make manifest who Jesus is. Do you remember the prologue to John's gospel? We read it on Christmas morning, on Sunday Christmas morning this year. In the beginning, right, is how John's gospel starts. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus is co-eternal, existed before all things, and through Jesus, the Word of God, all things came into being. So we're learning a lot about who Jesus is. And then here we have John the Baptist, who had a large following by this point, who points at Jesus and says, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Now, John's gospel, you may remember this, that there's four gospels. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are often referred to as the synoptic gospels, meaning they have the same view. They're very similar. We think Mark's gospel was the first to get written down, and then Matthew and Luke had Mark in hand in another document called Q that we don't have anymore. They were written down a little later. We think Mark 65, Luke and Matthew around 85. And then John's gospel, very different. And probably a lot later, 100, 125, still early, but all of them, you know, at least one generation or two after Jesus was raised from the dead and ascended into heaven. But John's gospel is just packed full of theologically important things. John's gospel says a lot. And one of the motifs, one of the themes that runs through John's gospel is this Lamb of God. So in John's gospel, the timing of his passion is a little different than the other three gospels. In the other three gospels, the Thursday before Jesus dies on Friday, the disciples are celebrating a Seder meal or Passover. In John's gospel, Jesus dies on the cross on the day of preparation when the priests would have been slaughtering the lambs in the temple. So in John's gospel, this idea of Jesus being the Lamb of God almost bookends the gospel. Here in chapter 1, John the Baptist points to him and says, twice, the Lamb of God. And then by the time we get to near the end and Jesus is dying on the cross, he's dying at the same time as the lambs. Now, remember your story from Exodus. The Passover, the Paschal Lamb, it wasn't a sacrifice for sin. They had those too. There were lambs and other animals that could be sacrificed, and the blood pouring on the altar and the parts of the animals burned on another altar of coals for the forgiveness of sins. But the Passover lamb was different. The Israelites, when they were captive, enslaved in Egypt, were instructed to sacrifice these lambs, not to break any bones, and to take the blood and to spread it on the doorpost and on the lintel, the part above the door, so that they would be spared from the final plague which would visit upon Egypt, which was the death of all firstborn, animals as well as humans. The Lamb of God is about deliverance. John says as much, to take away the sin of the world. And yet, it's different than any sacrifice that has ever existed because it removes the need for sacrifices. It's not just Judaism, but all of humanity has always had a need for scapegoats, has always had a need to sacrifice someone for the ills that affect us. And God is saying, no, there's another way. It's the way of love. It's the way of reconciliation. It's the way of mercy. And God became flesh in Jesus Christ to show us the way. Yes, he is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. But it's not a lamb that needs continual sacrificing. It's to show us that there is no need for that any longer. John also testified to the fact about the Spirit descending upon Jesus and remaining with him. Kind of a nice, for those of us that confess a Trinitarian God, it's kind of a nice, you know, summation of that. John testifies that this is the Son of God. Now, even that, some other people are sometimes called the Son of Gods. Sometimes it might be a priest or a prophet or a king. Caesars, even people who weren't Christians, sometimes were referred to as a Son of God. But this is different. As Christians, we confess that this really is God. God who was pleased to take on our flesh and our hurt and to embrace the mess and the pain and the sin of this world, to redeem it with love. So two of John's disciples take off and follow Jesus. Now, isn't this different? Just think about this. The other three Gospels all have Jesus' first words, either as a sermon or casting out a demon. Here, the first words Jesus speaks are, what do you seek? What are you looking for? And they respond by saying, where are you staying? Now, what's part of the problem why this seems so a little awkward is that the English isn't, it's not easy to translate the Greek into English because there's a Greek word meno that's being used here. And it's a word that might be better translated abide or staying. And it's more than just where you're sleeping at night. They want to know what's Jesus is about. Where are you abiding? Where are you staying? You know, and that's interesting because if you back up to that prologue, the Word became flesh and lived among us. That word is meno again, dwelt. One translator puts, pitched his tent. Another translator, he moved into the neighborhood. Where is he staying? Where is he menoing? Where is he abiding? That's what the disciples want to know. And what does Jesus say? Come and see. And that's the introduction of another light motif that works all the way through John's gospel. Seeing and believing. Or maybe better said, believing and then seeing through John's gospel. It's not that people see proofs that then convinces them of the truth of Jesus' divinity or God's love for them. It's that they experience the divinity. They experience the love of God for them. And then they start seeing with the eyes of faith. And of course, they even use terms like rabbi. And then when Andrew goes to find his brother Simon, he refers to Jesus as the Messiah, the anointed. It's the same word that we use when we say the word Christ. Christos, anointed one, the Messiah. So, important epiphanies, ways of us getting to know God, but how does that impact us? I'm pretty convinced, along with others, that the church's overall decline in the United States and even worldwide can be reversed. And I think the way that that can happen is for you and I to get better at seeing God's presence around us. And those of us that are still churchgoers, why is it that we go to church? There might be a lot of reasons. Maybe you love singing the hymns. Maybe you love seeing your friends. Maybe there's a hard-to-describe sense that you belong here. Those are all good reasons. There might even be more. Maybe you have had an experience of God in your life that made a difference. Maybe you were racked with grief, and the promise of resurrection and eternal life brought you comfort in the midst of that grief over a loved one that died. You've had that experience, that resurrection moment that brought you comfort. Maybe you have had an experience, a raw experience of God's mercy, where you felt so devastated by something that you had done, a sin that you had committed, a wrong that you have done, or a relationship that you had broken. And then you had experienced, again, the reconciling work of God's Spirit in your life. The words that are external to you that says, in the name of Jesus Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. And you were able to say, it's true. I'm forgiven. Or maybe it's time in your life when you felt totally unlovable because of either the way people treated you or the way that you thought about yourself. And again, somehow maybe it was the words of a counselor when you were at Bible camp as a kid. Maybe it was the words of a fellow parishioner as an adult. But somehow a glimpse of light came through the darkness that said, God loves you so much and that God will never let go of you. God has claimed you as one of God's children. It's those moments that I want us to embrace and to let linger, and then to be bold enough. This is the hard part. To be bold enough to share those times with other people. I'm convinced that's what's going to turn around the decline of the church, is when you and I can recognize the times when we encounter God in our life, the things that we love about coming to church that enhance those times or enables them, facilitates them, and then to be able to tell other people about it. So just two things. Seeing God's activity in our life and inviting others to come and see. To come and see the Lamb of God. It's why we don't sacrifice on the altar anymore. It's why we know that through the waters of baptism, God has claimed us as God's own. And that not only means that God is with us through this whole life, but God is actually for us, is pulling for us. And that through us, God's going to change the world. Amen. Our hymn of the day is related to all of this. Next slide will help me remember what it is. There it is. Christ be our light. Hymn number 715. The words will be on the screen. Please stand if it's comfortable.
Thank you.
Will you join me in the creed? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, only begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate to Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share the peace with one another. And as you're seated, our ushers will pass the plates for the offering. Again, just a reminder that by passing them down each pew, we're all participating on the ingathering of gifts, even if we only give once a month or electronically. It's still important that we are contributing this part of the service. You can go ahead and start, ushers. I just want to fill in a little bit here about our offering envelopes. Those normally get delivered to us in June or July of last year. There's been some kind of a supply train issue, supply line issue with the company, and the last word we've got is we may not get them till the second quarter. So I hope that you can continue to just write out a check, put regular offering in the memo, or if you don't put anything at all, that's how it will be counted. We're not that big of a church. Our secretary is able to post them correctly to the right households. So if you're used to using envelopes, I'm sorry that we don't have those yet. We'll get them out as soon as they're received. We continue with the offering.
Liberating God, you break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power, and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore, through Jesus our Savior. Amen.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Put a new song in the mouth of your church. Inspire the baptized to tell of your faithfulness, sharing the good news of your salvation throughout the earth. Bless the witness of missionaries, especially for Patrick and Jacqueline. Merciful God, the waters of baptism call us into life in the Spirit. Preserve the world's waters. Protect them from pollution. Support plants and animals who depend on them. And bring rain in places of drought. We also pray for relief from flooding, especially for California. Merciful God, and Jesus, you are the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Show your mercy to all nations. Direct leaders to do your will. Fill governing bodies with righteousness. Equip judges with discernment and compassion. Merciful God, you incline your ear to all who cry to you. Draw near to individuals and communities suffering violence, injustice, illness, and poverty. Hide them in the shadow of your hand and make a sign of your faithfulness to all in need. We pray especially for the Ukraine, also for Paul, Howard, Marlene, Duane, Bev, Mark, Alice, Barb, Olive, Helen, Darlene, Linda, and Kay. Merciful God, receive our prayers. You are glorified in the servants you have called. With Martin Luther King Jr., give us bold trust in you. Even when it feels like a sharp sword or polished arrow, give us courage to receive your call to repentance and racial justice. Merciful God, in every place and time you have sanctified your people. We praise you for the testimony of those who have died in the faith. Strengthen us as we wait for the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. We also pray that you bless those celebrating an anniversary of their baptism this week, including Mariah. Merciful God, we bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated for the announcements. Well, we know about our Croatian corner back there. And then our Japanese missionaries who we met just a few months ago, their daughters celebrating a birthday. Our annual meeting is following this service downstairs. There's also a potluck. So please come. No Sunday school today due to the annual meeting and potluck. Compass meets on Wednesdays at 6. That's the middle schoolers. Men's Bible study Thursdays at 8 in the chapel. Newsletter articles are due by Friday. The weekend women's Bible study, 8 a.m., Saturday the 21st at the Parsonage. Axis is the high schoolers. They meet every other Sunday, and the 22nd is their next time. We have a YouTube channel. And I know Angie's got an announcement for us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I fully believe the same things Pastor Tim does, that the church will turn around. But to do that, we all have to hang out together, right? So we're going to do something fun. Mark your calendars for Friday, February 3rd. I'm sorry, this is the only time we can do this. We're going to go bowling at Carousel Lanes, 7 o'clock. For those of you who don't bowl, bring a deck of cards. There is not food for order that night, but there are appetizers. Like, you can get onion rings, french fries, all that bad stuff for you. But And there will be beverages, but plan to come and join us at Carousel Lanes. We'll invite Bergen and Grace as well, and I'll get something in the bulletin for next week. Thanks.
And I happen to know, maybe from experience, that if you eat onion rings, you'll release your ball even better when you... And they'll have balls and shoes and things if you don't have your own equipment, so...
I do need a headcount.
Okay.
So I'll put a little sign up.
Do you happen to know if Carousel's got that ability to put up the bumpers for kids and then back down again for the adults?
I think they do, yes.
Good. So, you know, all ages, it'll be fun.
Yes, yeah. It's
an all-age thing. Yeah, good. Thank you. Maybe there's adults that need the bumpers. Is that what you guys are laughing about? Yeah, okay. Well, let's stand one more time. The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always. Amen. We sing, Arise, Your Light Has Come. The words will be on the screen. It's also hymn number 314.
We are disciples of Jesus Christ, called to grow in Christ and to invite all to follow him. Go in peace. Follow the way of Jesus. Thanks be to God.